Vicky, which is a bit unfamiliar, train for me to present slides. And in his next talk, Daniel will explain why these slides are on the wiki. I will talk today about a project that just started 1.5 years ago. A venue or journal, Electronic Proceedings in Theoretical Computer Science. And I will tell you why we did it, how we did it, and whatever else you want to know. If there is any information that I miss out on, please feel free to interrupt me either during the talk or at any time afterwards and ask for more clarification. So this is a venue for the rapid electronic publication of proceedings. It's refereed, it's open access, and it's free, meaning that authors or other agents do not pay for it either. In this talk, I will first tell a little bit about the archive, which is the place we use for archiving the papers. It's an independent organization that exists already for a long time. I will have to spend a few words on the difference between archival and publication in relation to the difference between EPTCS and archive. And then I will tell you why we did this and how we did this. So the archive is an open access repository. It's for the archival of papers. It covers computer science, mathematics, especially physics, that's where it's biggest in, biology and finance. The goal is to make papers available to each and everybody and preserve them for the future. All scientific papers are welcome in the archive. It's not a refereed thing. Any scientist, you have to show that you are a reputable scientist of some kind and not somebody who would to put spam there. But if you have a real scientific paper, you can get it in the archive. People, authors submit it themselves. These papers are not refereed and no costs are presented to the author or to the reader of the archive. The goal is just to make papers available and to preserve them for the future. So a lot of money is invested, well, a lot, it's all very relatively. There is government subsidy and university library, Cornell library subsidy to keep the archive going. And no cost and effort is paid, are spared to make a platform where papers will still be available many centuries from now. In particular, it's not just in the shape of PDFs that that papers are presented, but the source code in whatever is the appropriate form for a particular paper or data set, XML, LaTeX source code, that's how it's preserved. Most computer scientists, and I'm talking here as a computer scientist, use the LaTeX typesetting system. So it's the LaTeX source code that is being preserved there. In the beginning, it was expanded into PostScript. Currently, the same source code is expanded into PDF. And maybe next century, PDF is out, but we still have the source code to make something else out of it. The archive has a nice web interface that let any author upload their source codes and metadata. The papers have very cursory reviews by archive staff for appropriateness and for classification in a particular branch of computer science or physics or what have you. They are not reviewed in the sense that there are referees at work here. The archive has about 6,000 new papers each month. Well, now on archival versus publication, the scientific community these days insists that you cannot publish a paper twice. There is one official place where it's published, and that's the thing that people cite on their CVs, and that really counts. You don't put the same paper all over the place. However, if the same source is published, made available, first as a technical report of a university, or as something that's available on the webpage of the author, it doesn't count as a publication. So the question is, what does count as a publication? And for this purpose, we kind of distinguish between archival, and that's what the archive does, versus real publication, and that's what the publisher does. And I write publication with a capital letter here to indicate it doesn't count technical reports and stuff. It's something that somehow sanctions and officially counted as a real publication. So the archive is just for archival, and a journal like EPTCS adds the other stage, the actual publication. So I will come to what that entails. In computer science, conference papers are almost similar in status to journal publications. They are often, or almost all the time, thoroughly reviewed. Some conferences can be very competitive. On the CV, a conference paper is almost just as good as a journal publication. Of course, it depends on the conference and on the journal, but often some conferences are much more important than some journals. This is a different in one field from the other. There are also areas where conference papers just do not count as real publications. For workshops, and this is one of the main targets of EPTCS, there are two kinds of workshops. You have formal proceedings workshop and informal proceedings workshop. Some subdisciplines have more of the one and some have more of the other. A formal proceedings workshop is like a conference, but smaller. Typically, it's a one-day event instead of a five-day event. It focuses on a more narrow area. It allows speakers to focus on technical details. And it can be equally prestigious as a big conference. An informal workshop is just a place for like-minded people to brainstorm. The papers are not formally refereed, and they are just there to help the workshop remember what they are talked about. So the informal workshop proceedings papers do not really count as publications on one CV, but the formal proceedings workshops do. EPTCS is a venue that publishes proceedings of conferences and of formal proceedings workshop. All the archival is done at the archive. So the actual storage of the paper is not really our business. We publish and the archive archives. So what is the added value of EPTS with respect to the spontaneous archival of a paper which any author can do anyway? That's the publications are well refereed. They count as an official publication. They can be listed at somebody's CV. That doesn't hold for any thing that people stick in the archive because that's just their own doing. So it's the publication status that makes the difference. We founded EPTS in 2009, just over a year ago, basically because we didn't find a suitable free open access venue for the publications of proceedings covering theoretical computer science. It's a very small area. I'm a theoretical computer scientist. I happen to be in the steering committee of a workshop that didn't find a good outlet, and there were many workshops in the same situation. And it's based on a hole in the market that a few scientists came together, me in particular, and started to work on an alternative. One of our competitors, so to say, is Electronic Notes in Theoretical Computer Science. It's an Elsevier journal, which used to be, I would say, the default for workshops in theoretical computer science. So proceedings of workshops were published as an ENTCS volume. It's not open access, and it used to be free, but since 2009 it's not. And since many workshops had a rather small budget, they got a little bit into problems. $50 a paper is a totally insignificant amount of money compared to the salary of the author in the time that they write the paper. But for many workshops, this was just too big a post on the workshop budget, and they they searched for alternatives. So ENTCS is 36 proceedings a year, roughly. Another competitor, which is a bigger thing, is LNCS. They typically focus on conferences of a larger scale rather than smaller workshops. They're not open access. They are free for authors and conferences. It's only the reader that pays, and they are much bigger. partly because they cover all of computer science rather than just the niche of theoretical computer science. So EPTCS covers theoretical computer science. It's free completely and it's open access. The peer review is totally delegated to the conference or workshop that publish their proceedings as a volume in our venue. Conferences apply to be published in this series. There is a web form for that, and then there is a board of editors which are carefully selected to be rather respectable people in the field. And they do not referee any paper that's published in EPTCS. They referee a workshop or a conference, and they decide if the program committee of that workshop or conference is up to the task of ensuring a certain level of quality. So there is in some sense a two-level quality management. All the real work is done by the conference of the workshop, and it's only the second level where the editorial board of EPTCS comes into action. And that's one of the way that we keep the administrative process manageable and the cost down. So we have 26 editors covering all of theoretical computer science and a completely automatic workflow for handling applications of proceedings. So the editors have some discussion forums and take their decisions. The publication process is completely automatic. There are people involved, of course, but there is a workflow that presents all involved parties with the task at hand. The authors or the volume editors, depending on what they choose, upload papers as LaTeX source code in our house style. There is a web interface in which volume auditors inspect the papers that authors have downloaded. There is some metadata that needs to be filled in, and we want both volume authors and our own staff to check off on every paper so that all three parties agree that one version is the ultimate thing. Sometimes an author submits something, the workshop editors edit in it to make it consistent with whatever their vision is, and then the authors still need to say, yes, we approve with these changes. So our staff checks formatting requirements, English context, and metadata, but on a very simple and superficial level, just to make sure that some minimal requirement is met, because the real quality control is in hands of the workshops or the conferences. So upon publication, papers are completely automatically transferred to the archive. We also upload for every workshop or every conference one HTML cover page. That is the workshop. It contains the preface, some invited talk abstracts, and for every paper, a table of contents with for every paper a link to the archive that shows how the paper actually is published. And it creates a big PDF of the entire proceedings, which is sent to the conference organizers to be printed at the venue and distributed to participants. The staff is very small. This is a relatively small project. There is an editor-in-chief, which is me. I spent about 1 hour a week in this capacity. There is a webmaster, which is also me. That so far cost me about 3 hours a week. We have a copy editor who looks if the formatting of all papers are fine, 1 hour a week. And a person specifically dealing with correspondence with everybody who has a question, who spends only 10 minutes a week on this. And nevertheless, we publish about 300 papers a year, so far at least. And it looks like it's working with a small amount of effort to still put up a high-quality resource. I don't know what's happening at this stage. This is probably the last slide. So if I scroll down, I will get to the actual homepage of this journal. This is how it looks. There is a little bit blurb about what happens. We could go to the editorial board. So then you see just some names of people that are involved in it. Most interesting here is the list of published volumes. And this is in reverse chronological order our output. We could put dates in that to see at what rate it goes. Let's say publication dates. So here you see in August we published 3 volumes, in July there were 2, and that's roughly the rate in which it goes. This is at our own webpage, but if we click on an arbitrary volume, we get out of our own system into the archive. So this is a totally different organization now, who published archived the proceedings of this very conference. We see a table of conference. Of contents, it's invited presentations, some papers, so I go all the way down here, I meant to do that more gradually. So this is a table of contents, and then a preface, and then a few little blurbs of invited talks that are not published as a real paper, but still want to be present. And for every paper, if you click on an arbitrary paper, there's my mouse here, then we get to another page also at the archive where this paper is stored, and you can get it in PDF, PostScript, or a bunch of other forms that the archive currently supports. And this is how it looks. I think I've roughly covered the basic issues. I would be happy to demonstrate all the other bits of the website, but it's probably more interesting to just use the time in answering any questions that some of you may have.
Okay, who'd like to ask a question? Okay.
Thanks a lot and congratulations on the efficiency. That's really impressive because we think we are already efficient, but 10 minutes of correspondence only per week that I wish I could do. In any case, what I think what would be also a good topic for you as publishers here to discuss a bit more is really this thing with real or not publication, right? I think really if you go into web pages of publishers, and I'm speaking again of Nature, even Nature, I think they are doing a very good job professionally describing what they do, and they are expanding like crazy, as you know, but even they have a problem with the word publication. I think a publication is everything that is being made publicly available, and I think it's not good to speak of real and not real publications. I think we should really try to converge on peer-reviewed publications, which is the criterion in this case, and other publications, right? So I think in general, that's really one thing that might also help innovative publishers to really just come to common terms, not exactly to use the same terms. We have many different things, but I'm not sure if archival publication versus real publication is the best distinction. I would really suggest peer-reviewed and not peer-reviewed, and then you can add other attributes as you would like. I don't know, what is your opinion on that one?
Well, I think peer-reviewed is a very important point, but whether an article is peer-reviewed or not, or whether it's in an open access journal or not, still leaves open the question if it's published in the sentence that you cannot publish the same material somewhere else. Even if you put a paper in an open access journal, that means you could spread around the content anywhere else, you could distribute it without any problem. You can then not submit it to another journal, not even to another open access journal, and say, hey, I'm a scientist, I have this beautiful idea, would you want to publish it too? And then they would say, no, it has already been published. So there is this thing that a scientific contribution can be published only once. I'm not saying that this is right, but the entire scientific community currently seems to believe in that. And I'm not the one to challenge this as well, next to all the other things I want to challenge. So it's only for the purpose of this unwritten or written law that a thing, it may be archived multiple times, it might not be published multiple times, that I like to use the word publication with a capital P as distinguished from normal publication with a small letter P. And with that I mean it's any act that comes with a moral prohibition to submit it to a journal as another publication. If you stick something in the archive or you make it a university technical report, it's not published in that sense. It's published in your sense perhaps, but you could then still send it to a journal as a submission. And if it's published with a capital P, it's not. So if you have a good word for that, which not necessarily implies or is implied by peer review, I'd be welcome to hear a better term.
Okay, thank you very much. Any other questions? Oh, sorry.
Astrid van Wezenbeek, Spark Europe. How did you market your journal? Did you use your 26 editors for...
I used the 26 editors to talk to people that they knew. And we sent announcements of the journals to all of the major email lists that us 26 editors were aware of that cover the area of theoretical computer science. We decided to keep it limited to that area because it was a bit of an experiment and we didn't want to overreach our goal. And within that area, those 26 people basically knew what mailing list people were reading. And we just sent it to that, and there were a few blogs written here and there, and that's all we did. And then to our surprise, actually, quite a few signs of interest showed up, and conferences applied to be published here through our web forum. In fact, we had thought maybe there will be only 5 workshops a year that want to publish it, and even then we would have solved the problem of how to publish the proceedings of the one conference where some of us were in the steering committee of. But in fact, there were quite a few other workshops and conferences that apparently were struggling with the same question, and they just jumped off it when they heard it.
Are all articles in a preceding volume published on the same publication date? So do you wait to complete all the volume?
Yes, we wait to complete an entire volume so that all the articles are continuously page numbered, for instance. If you print, we concatenate the PDFs of the individual article to get the conference proceedings, and it looks like one consistent volume.
So if I could just ask a clarification question. The process, the editorial process that mm-hmm. happens before the publication step, that's all happening independent of archive, right? So that's all going through a different system.
Yes, so there is an editorial process where our editors decide whether a particular conference is worthy to be published. Yeah. That happens on a bit of the website that our journal manages. And there is an editorial process within each conference that decides on the refereeing and discussion of the accepted papers. And that happens within the realm of that conference. And that's independent of both Archive and EPTCS.
I see. So Archive is essentially being used as a dissemination platform.
Yes. It's just, for us, a dissemination platform.
And do you know if anyone else is thinking of recreating this model?
Yes. In fact, we were not the first to do this. One of the more prestigious journals in theoretical computer science is called LMCS, Logical Methods in Computer Science. And it also, it's not a conference proceeding series, it's a scientific journal. It also disseminates their content as an overlay for the archive. So we are not the first, and I think that there might be other people that want to follow this idea. I think there is a lot to say for it, because this is such a small undertaking that nobody would have confidence we are still around in the year 2400, whereas they might think that the archive gives them a good chance of surviving the centuries.
All right, well, I think we'll move on. Thank you very much, Rob.
Yeah, my pleasure.
And thank you.